is John Cullough with growingyourgreens.com. Today we have another exciting episode for you here in my beautiful backyard garden. Here in August, things are in full tilt, full production. Check my last video or two videos ago where I did a tour so you guys could see what I'm growing. In this episode, we're going to have hopefully a shorter video, and I'm going to show you guys the best way to use your basil to get the most antioxidant benefit, right? You can see I have lots of basil. This is just standard green basil. Actually, all these were bought from the dollar store, literally as like hydroponic, plants that you cut to eat. Instead, I grew them out, rooted them, and now they are, you know, maybe like, some of them are 6 feet tall, including the raised bed that's like 18 inches tall. You can see they just go all the way down. And as much as I have a lot of basil leaves to harvest and eat to make pesto out of, you know, one of the ways I like to use basil is to use the flower tops even more, because as you'll learn in this episode, they are two times more, right, even a little bit more than two times more antioxidant rich, right? Antioxidants are anti-aging compounds, anti-free radical compounds. Plus also, you guys are into cannabis growing, right? You guys don't want to smoke the leaves. That's like shake. You guys want the flowers because you know the flowers are where all the nutrients are, where the terpenes and cannabinoids are at that give you those effects that you like, that I personally don't like. That being said, every flower has higher levels of these different things like terpenes and antioxidants and essential oils. And basil is rich in these terpenes as well, just like your cannabis. So I want you guys to use your basil flowers. I don't know if you're going to hear any other gardener, because they're probably not crazy as I am, or into health as much as I am, to tell you to use your basil flowers. A lot of you guys might just top your flowers so you get more leaf growth, which I have been doing. But every time I top my flowers, well, not every time, but almost every time I top my flowers, I will top them and then use them and get them into me so that I could get the benefits. In this video, I'm going to show you guys the best way to use your basil flowers to get the terpenes and antioxidant benefit and essential oils into you. So as much as I am growing green basil, you guys got to see I have a whole lot of green basil in this row here. These are actually extra plants I just threw in there. I'm really going to focus on the purple basil today. So you guys are also going to learn the differences between purple basil and the green basil, and which is more healthy or antioxidant rich for you guys. So let's go to the other side of my garden and let's harvest some purple basil flowers. All right, so as you guys can see, we're next to one of my beds that have basil growing, and I like to try to keep up with my basil as it's growing. So this bed I harvested recently, but we're gonna harvest again. You know, I like to cut off all the basil flowers or just pinch them off actually. So you can see it's this one's flowering. So we'll just come off and just pinch the top off. You know, sometimes I'll have some little scissors if the stalks get a bit more mature and old, so I'll just cut them off. And I want you guys to harvest these in different stages, so you guys can see this one's a lot bigger than the smaller, you know, unformed buds right there. This also has little flower petals, which we'll be talking about also a little bit. But I also want you guys to not forget about some of the dried materials too, because you know there are some different nutrients and phytochemicals in each of the different, you know, when it's a baby, when it's full mature or not. I mean, this probably has some seeds in there as well because this is more dried out. I want you guys just to harvest them all. So what I'm going to do now is we're going to go through this whole bed. I'm going to go around and pinch off all these flower tops, and this will give me a lot of flower material to work with that I will need for my next step. I process these in like big bulk batches. So as you guys can see, I've harvested my basil and I'm all set up and ready to process it in the best way I found, and I'm going to share it with you guys. So you guys can see I harvested basil. This is off two beds, my red Reuben, mostly the flower tops with some leaves on there. And then you can see I harvested maybe off like 1.5 beds all my flower tops of my standard Italian basil. I'll be doing two different things with these. The purples will get used now. And they'll get blended into watermelon, or vacuum blended into watermelon juice, so then I could drink those as a nice juice. It'll be basil flower infused watermelon juice. And then on the green basil, I'll be infusing that into vinegar. So the juice that you make, you could maybe store it for up to a week in a cold fridge under vacuum, as I will show with you guys. But if you guys do the apple cider vinegar, that should pretty much store indefinitely because of the acid in the vinegar. So we're going to show you guys both ways. So this could be used, you know, over the winter when you don't have your basil, so that you could get some of the antioxidant properties from your basil. Now, I also want to let you guys know that, you know, I just don't come up with these harebrained schemes to do these things. You know, I do a lot of research. So here's a published scientific study, actually came out in 2020, and I'm quite thankful for the authors, and it is called Insights into Composition of Bioactive Phenolic Compounds in Leaves and Flowers of Green and Purple Basil. This exact study I wanted. We could go into basil as a culinary, medicinal, and ornamental plant appreciated for its antioxidant properties, mainly attributed to its high content of rosmaric acid. This species also includes purple varieties characterized by the accumulation of anthocyanins in leaves and flowers. So we'll go ahead and jump down to the summary. Moreover, the study reveals that purple leaves mainly contain highly acrylated anthocyanins, while purple flowers accumulate anthocyanins with a low degree of decoration. Overall, the study provides new biochemical information about the presence of not yet characterized bioactive compounds in basil that could contribute to boosting the use of this crop and to gaining new knowledge about the roles of these compounds in plant physiology. All right, so here's the thing, like, I didn't print out the part where it has all the different compounds that they have identified in basil. I mean, here's the thing, plants are chemical factories. Every different kind of plant produces different chemicals, and I believe they can all be beneficial for us if used appropriately. That being said, one of the coolest tables was on page 4, and I printed out on the back here, and it goes into the different kinds of basil. They basically tested like a standard Italian, a red ruby, and a dark opal basil. And I only have like the red Reuben today, but the red Reuben and the dark opal were pretty similar in the results. And so anyways, on the leaf variety, the total phenols in the leaves for the green leaves were 5.57, in the red ruby it was 7.11, and in the dark opal it was 6.07. So those are the total phenols in the leaves. Now let's go to the total phenols in the flowers, what I harvested today. The green 3.58, red Reuben 4.35, and the dark opal 4.54. So that's about half as much. You're like saying, John, how could these be twice as nutritious when it's got half as many phenols? Well, let's go over to the anthocyanins. Of course, the leaves in the green leaves had 0.01 anthocyanins, and the red Reuben had 3.96. The dark opal had 3.68. The flowers of the green had 0.02, so a little bit double the amount of the leaves, but the red Reuben anthocyanins in the flowers had 0.87, and then dark opal had 0.75. So that's, you know, 40 times more than the green variety in the opal. That being said, if you want the anthocyanins, then the leaves are better sourced. But if we move over to the antioxidant capacity, this is testing in a test tube. The leaf of the green was 63.48, the red Reuben was 68.98, and the dark opal was 61.45. All fairly similar in the 60s, right? But now if we go down to the flowers, which is what I harvested today, the green had 148, which is over twice as much as the leaf of the green, and then the red Reuben had 133.45, so that's less than the green, but also it has the anthocyanin content that the green didn't have. And the dark opal had 100.44. So that's not quite the antioxidant capacity of the leaves. So that's why I want you guys to use your flowers. Plus, to me, flowers are a waste product. Most people grow their basil for their leaves to make pesto and different various recipes out of. But I want you guys to use your flowers to your benefit, because they are, in general, twice as high in antioxidant capacity than the leaves. Plus, as a gardener, they're a waste product, because if you don't keep cutting these off, you're going to stop your leaf production. So now I want to get into how to process them the best way possible. Most people just take the leaves and then put them in a blender and then blend them up with, you know, the watermelon. And I don't do that, right? If you know me and have been watching me for a while, you know that I'm really into vacuum blending. Vacuum blending is next level technology that, according to some published science I've seen, can preserve 2 to 3 times more of certain polyphenol antioxidants. You know, these are rich in polyphenols and antioxidants, and I do not want to lose them through the oxidative damage. I mean, if you harvest basil and you just brush against it, right, and put a crease in it, you know, it'll turn brown. It'll oxidize very fast. This is why basil, one of the reasons why basil does not travel or ship well. It bruises easily, and then, you know, just like cutting open apple, it turns brown, starts to go bad. So I want to minimize this during the processing, but I want to fractionate all these cell walls to break open the nutrients that are revealed inside, that they're revealed in that study there. So the best way I found to do that is in a vacuum blender. We have, this is the Tribest DynaPro 2250. If you're interested in buying this blender that I use, link down below in the description. It also comes with a vacuum pump, so literally you put a vacuum pump on there, and we'll be doing this in a second. We'll press the button, it'll evacuate the excess oxygen out of the craft, so that when you're blending, you're not blending in an oxygen-rich environment, you're blending in an oxygen-deprived environment. This will allow you to keep more of these beneficial polyphenols and antioxidants that may get oxidized. So what I'm going to do today is we have about 200 grams of the basil, so we're going to use one watermelon and 100 grams. And then the other watermelon and the other 100 grams. So to save you guys some time, I'm just gonna go ahead and chop up the watermelon, put it in. Now you could use the watermelon skin and all if you wanted to. I'm gonna be cutting off the skin because I want the watermelon juice sweeter, because the basil is already gonna make the juice taste quite strong. So we got all the watermelon cut up, and we're gonna go ahead and put that in the blender. But I wanna let you guys know that if you don't have watermelon, that's all right. You don't need to use watermelon, right? I don't have watermelon, I can't do the recipe. I've done this with honeydew melon. I've done this with cantaloupe melon. If you're doing honeydew or cantaloupe or even watermelons, yes, you can put in the seeds. That'll add some extra fat into the blended mixture. We'll be removing these in a little bit. You could also use something like apples. You know, just make sure you put a lot of apples in the bottom. You could use oranges. You could use basically any kind of fruit will work for this task. Heck, you could even use something like coconut water. All right, so we're going to go ahead and take about half these basil. Half the basil here. Now, if I was smart, I probably would pre-cut this in a little smaller pieces so it'll sink down a bit better when we're blending. I think that's probably about half right there. We're gonna go ahead and put the lid on the DynaPro vacuum blender. We're gonna go ahead and put that on the top, and we're gonna go ahead and put the vacuum pump on and press the button. You could hear very silently this pump comes on, and now what's happening is it's sucking out the excess oxygen out of the craft. You may see a few bubbles, you know, come out of the below where there's liquid in the watermelon. It's going to pump down to about, I think, 19 inches of mercury is what the pump is rated at. You know, so now when you're blending, you're not oxidizing the food. In a traditional blender, all traditional blenders, you see a vortex, a funnel cone in the middle of the blender when you're running it. This is like a tornado. Some of you guys may have gotten your houses or known people that have gotten their houses destroyed by a tornado. That's the power of the wind and the oxygen, you know, that's causing all the damage. So we want to prevent this in the vacuum blender. Now, some other cool benefits of vacuum blending, besides preserving more nutrients, which is my major point, is that you get less separation, you keep a more desirable color, you get more flavors. And, you know, flavors are equated with nutrients. When you have more flavors, that means more nutrients, and when you have something with less flavor, you're oxidizing nutrients. Like if I did the same recipe in a traditional blender versus a vacuum blender, it would taste more dull. In addition, you're not going to have the dissolved air bubbles in the mixture, so that you're not going to get as much or any gas or bloating when you drink the smoothies. And then it shuts itself off, so now we know we have maximum vacuum achieved. So now we can go ahead and hit the pulse button once and then the blend button once. And what's going to happen is it'll pulse blend for 30 seconds, so it'll allow everything to get into the bottom, and then it'll just blend on full speed for 30 seconds, and then we'll be done. So this happens all automatically without you having to do anything. Alright, so it's all blended up. Now I do need to let you guys know that I sell juicers and blenders for a living, so if you guys need to purchase a juicer or this vacuum blender, please support me in my work and make your purchase at discountjuicers.com. This allows me to continue to make these videos that you guys are watching today. I appreciate it so much. Now the next step is we're going to go ahead and strain this out. You could drink this now, but it's a smoothie and it's going to be very texturous because of all the hard fibers of the stalks of the flowers. So once we're gonna go ahead and take this up front and center. We're gonna pull this, and I want you guys to listen carefully. That's all the oxygen rushing back into the craft. And I think we had a straggler that did not get blended, so we'll put it in the next batch. And now what we're gonna do is we're gonna go ahead and take this mixture and put it through the best nut milk bag that I found. This is the BlendTech nut milk bag. They have been discontinued, but they will be getting rebranded and soon, and I should be selling those also at discount juicers once they are out. All right, so we got the whole mixture into the nut milk bag, and all we're gonna do now is just basically strain this out. This will remove all the fiber. Now, you could use a sieve, and that'd be a pain to use. This is the right tool for the right job that I found. You know, in many cases, I just juice like this by blending up fruits and vegetables in the blender and extracting it out just like this. It makes a very high yield and also makes the best flavored juice. Once again, that's because we're not oxidizing things. We're not adding additional air. And if you don't run the blender too long, you're not going to generate any significant amount of heat either. We started with cold watermelon today, and this juice mixture, as I'm pressing it out, is still quite cold. All right, so I'm just about done squeezing out all the juice out of this pulp, and we're going to go ahead and shake this pulp down and try to get it all out, because I want to show you guys actually what's left. Sometimes I do a double extraction, which you could do. I would do it maybe in water or coconut water, something you have laying around. I wouldn't use like some new virgin fruit. There'll be something left in here, but it's really not that potent from my testing. You know, I've processed ginger and turmeric and other, you know, I processed my rosemary this way also. You could do this with mint. And I mean, this is literally what we're left with. Literally, we started with whole basil and we're left with this powdered, fractionized, you know, vacuum blended mixture. Now we're gonna go ahead and try to eat that. Don't usually eat it. Wow, it's kind of good. It's like tad sweet and then it's just chewy. Not a lot of flavor in there. That's kind of good. Maybe I could dehydrate and make it a dog treat. Is basil okay with your dogs? I don't know. All right, so once we're done making this, we could go ahead and take this and pour this in our jar, because I'm going to save it for later. Maybe I'll drink some of it now. All right, so once we got that, now we want to save this, right? You could just cap this off with, you know, a lid, and cap it off and put it in your fridge. That being said, to me, oxygen is the worst thing that's gonna damage your juice faster than anything else. So we wanna remove the excess oxygen in the head space in this container, plus maybe any oxygen that may, small amounts of oxygen that may be dissolved in the juice. So how we're gonna do this is we're gonna take the, once again, the blender carafe here. We're gonna set this lid on and not screw it down tight, but just a little bit to keep the lid in place. We're gonna set the whole jar into the blender carafe. Now we're gonna go ahead and put the lid on the blender carafe, and now we're gonna go ahead and suck a vacuum. So what's happening now is the DynaPro vacuum blender carafe is my personal vacuum chamber. I'm now creating a vacuum in this chamber. What's happening is all the oxygen is being sucked out of the jar. The oxygen in the top of the jar is being sucked out, and it's going between for the rim of the jar and the lid, like between this space as I move it up and down. So if you guys could see like how that's going, this is moving like this, and it's basically forcing this lid down into the jar because it's under vacuum. So now we're evacuating the oxygen out of the jar. This is very important. If you don't do this step, your juice could store for maybe 3 days, and after that it'll start to, you know, start tasting really bad, and the taste will change a lot. But if you store it like this, I've stored it easily for 7 days. That being said, I wouldn't necessarily recommend 7 days. Maybe go with like five days maybe. And if you want to experiment more, that's up to you. If you do want to save this for a longer period of time, like knowingly, then I would add something like some extra lemon juice. And also, you know, maybe put a half a lemon in when you're doing this recipe so you could store it for longer. All right, so let's go ahead and see if that's done vacuuming. All right, we had a vacuum on the carafe. That's a good sign. And if we pull this out, you guys can see this lid is concave. So if we tip it upside down, it's not falling out because we have a nice vacuum on the jar. So we got one down. I still got to do the other one. Before I go on though, I want to go ahead and taste test the watermelon with purple basil flour right here. Super nutritious. Now, I don't know if I mentioned it, but you want to use about 100 grams or 150 max to one small watermelon. So you'll make about 32 ounces of juice. If you have larger watermelons, use about that ratio. Otherwise, I found it could be very strong. I've made it very strong and I haven't had any ill effects, but if you're sensitive and never done this before, you might want to start with less basil because this stuff can be quite potent. That's good. So, I mean, it gives you a zing in your mouth. I feel like it's not quite the burn, but it's like really a lot of like, I feel like essential oils, but I also get the sweetness of the watermelon. In the summertime, I usually try to drink like this every day or every other day, usually, but I got like 4 or 5 different juicers in my fridge that I rotate from daily, and this is one of them. So as you guys can see, I now have 2 vacuum sealed jars, quart jars of the watermelon basil juice, purple basil. We have 1 whole extra glass I get to try. Man, to me, this is just so refreshing. Basil doesn't taste like mint, but like it reminds me just because of sweetness of the watermelon. You got the lycopene from the watermelon, plus all the phenols and antioxidants and even some anthocyanins from my purple basil. This just tastes amazing. Seriously, guys, you got to make this. This is one of the healthiest drinks you could make out of basil. Now, while these need to be used within the next 7 days, if kept cold, I'm going to show you guys how you could preserve your basil even into the winter and even into next year by using this next technique, which is pretty much the same thing, but instead of using fresh watermelon that can't expire, we're going to use some ACV, apple cider vinegar with the mother. This is the live stuff. You can get the Bragg's brand. I get mine at Costco. It's raw and unfiltered. I want to make sure you guys use the raw and unfiltered apple cider vinegar, right? So we're just going to go ahead. We shook it up, and now we're going to go ahead and literally pour this whole 32 ounces into the blender craft. Now I do have some residual in there, I'm not really worried about it. The acidity in vinegar is so high that it's gonna basically preserve anything. If you guys have made things like fire cider, which I think is a scam that, you know, one company trademarked that name personally. This is like a, you know, a basically basil vinegar, not a fire cider, but you could also, you know, use basil as one of the ingredients in your fire cider if you wanted to. So what we're going to do now is we're just go ahead and take the basil. Now, very important, right? We want to macerate and chop the basil up into small, fine particle sizes so we can basically extract and get out all those valuable antioxidant polyphenols and other nutrients. So this time we're using about 32 ounces of the apple cider vinegar, and we have approximately a little bit over 200 grams of the basil. So I have lots of basil in here. More than I had last time, because this is going to use like a vinegar where you don't use a lot of it, but it's really going to pack a nice punch, in the vinegar that you could use later for cooking, and you could still get some of the benefits of your basil later in the year. Once again, we got to put that vacuum lid on, and we're going to go ahead and suck a vacuum on it. This time, since we're sucking a vacuum on liquid, you could clearly see some of the air bubbles that's trapped in between the basil and the apple cider vinegar coming up and evacuating out. This is a good sign that the vacuum blender is working. So the pump shut off. We're going to go ahead and remove that now, and I'm probably just going to go ahead and hit the blend button like twice. Alright, so it ran about a minute and we have a fully blended up mixture. I mean, look at that, you can't see anything left in there. I mean, it's almost like a vinegar smoothie now. Once again, let the air back in, and now we can go ahead and process this. Now, I do want to let you guys know that, you know, the DynaPro is a commercial blender. It's NSF certified. You could use it in restaurants and juice bars, or you could just use it in your home, but know that it is commercial quality. It has a nice fat carafe, so this is really conducive to vacuum blending. It vacuum blends a lot easier than a small narrow carafe. And it also has, you know, I don't know, like 2.5 horsepower, some crazy amount of horsepower to get all your jobs done. I've blended some crazy stuff in this, and it just powers right through it without any issue. In addition, this has the longest warranty in the industry of any blender that I'm aware of, 15 years. Wow, and I'm smelling that basil vinegar mixture. Whoa, man, that'll wake you up. All right. Yeah, that's quite strong. It's straight up vinegar with basil. Once again, we're going to go ahead and pour it through our extractor bag. Tap it all out. And make sure you don't have any open cuts when you're doing this. with the vinegar, otherwise it's gonna burn because this is like a, you know, acid. Now this mixture is a little bit warm because I did blend it a minute. If you want to not be as warm, you could blend it a little bit less. That being said, I want to make sure all the particle sizes are completely fractionated. Now today I am actually choosing to extract this out right now. You could leave this whole mixture as we took it out of the blender and just put it in a jar and let it sit for 6 months and kind of seep and extract more new things out of it if you wanted to. You know, if I do that, then that jar is probably going to sit on the shelf forever because I'll probably not extract it and then I'll probably have other things to do. For that reason, I'm extracting it now. And, you know, some extraction now is better than no extraction later. But optimally, I would like to let this sit. I did this same kind of method where I extracted like a hemp flower and leaves and stalk actually in this same method. And it is still sitting in my house, just the blended mixture that I will be straining out probably in a little bit. All right, so luckily I have no cuts, so nothing's burning because of the vinegar. And it's amazing, you know, I mean, John, could I use a press? Like I'm in Norwalk. Well, you could use a Norwalk press to press this pulp out. But I'll tell you guys, you know, you guys ever see some videos on the Juicero? Once you get things to a finest particle size, right, your hands are the most efficient tools to press things out. We don't need a $2,300 press or $600 or $300 press you could jack up with a jack, you know. Our hands work really well, you know, and this will give you some good exercise too. Keep my hands in shape. And wringing it out like I'm wringing out my clothes in old-fashioned days. All right, so we got this quite dry. Can't even wring out anymore. And let's go ahead and take a look and see what we got. I like how this cleans up easy. I just tap it down and pretty much everything comes out. And then literally with my garden hose, it's like where the camera is, I have a little outdoor sink set up. I'm gonna spray this down high pressure water, and it takes about 2.5 gallons because I measured it, it collects in my 5 gallon bucket to basically spray it clean with no scrubbing. So this is what we got left from our basil. Look at this. We fully extracted this. I mean, if we dehydrated this, this would be like sawdust. All these particles are finally broken down. The cell wall is broken open, so we got all the nutrients out. Now I'm gonna go ahead and try this. Wow. That's quite interesting. So it's just basically fiber. I'm not having any basil flavor and basil punch. I think we got a pretty complete extraction. I'm getting a hint of vinegar, which is nice because it's not overpowering vinegar, but it's just like, no, it's a little acid, maybe a little, tastes a little bit salty, but it's mostly fiber. To me, this is good for my microbes. They're gonna get to eat them in my compost pile. All right, so once we have this mixture now, this mixture, because we did extract it in vinegar, will basically stay fresh without going bad because of the acidity content. So literally all I'm gonna do, I'm gonna pour it back into the bottle it came in and just let it sit in the bottle that it came in and use it as I need it. So now I have a basically a basil infused vinegar to use, apple cider vinegar, raw living, you know, whenever I need it. And actually it looks like we made a little bit more than the container holds because we extracted some of the nutrients. So we have more than we started with. So maybe I'll use that today in my salad dressing. And then we got there, we could go ahead and cap this off. And you want to label this, let you guys know what you got. And now we have literally basil extracted vinegar. So this has the basil antioxidants, preserved, shelf stable. And we have it the other way, used within 7 days. I really hope you guys enjoyed this episode, learning more about how to harvest and use your basil flowers, the best way to use them to extract more nutrients under vacuum, storing them, extracting them in a liquid, either vinegar or the juice, and learning about the scientific studies showing that the basil flowers have twice as many antioxidants than the basil leaves. I want you guys to use your flowers. This is two of the ways that I found. If you guys come up with any new ways, post down below in the comments down below. I'd love to hear them. You know, I strive to optimize my techniques to grow the highest quality, nutrient-dense food, but more importantly, also use that food and extract the food in the best ways possible so that more of those bioactive compounds could get into me. And this is what I share for you guys. Like, there's no other YouTube channel that is sharing what I share. So if you appreciate my video, please like this video. It'll help the YouTube algorithm make this video more popular so that more people could be exposed to the knowledge that I share that literally you're not gonna hear anywhere else, because I come up with all these crazy ideas in my garden when I'm gardening, and how can I use my basil flowers? And you know, this is a new technique that I came up with actually this year that I want to share with you guys. Also be sure to click that subscribe button right down below so you don't miss out on my new and upcoming episodes. I've come out every 5 to 7 days. You never know where I'll show up or what you'll be learning on my YouTube channel. Make sure you click the little bell so you get notified as my new videos come out. And finally, be sure to check my past episodes. My past episodes are a wealth of knowledge. Over 1,600 episodes at this time on this YouTube channel dedicated to teach you guys all about how to grow your own food and process them in the best ways possible to maintain more nutrients so that you can be healthier because of it. So with that, my name is John Kohler with growingyourgreens.com. We'll see you next time. And until then, remember, keep on growing.